time this. And this is a time of intercession and prayer. Based on various news items that I've received. And the first one is from the Society for the Distribution of Hebrew Scriptures. And it's called Distribution in Leeds. The city of Leeds is one with 1.25 million souls. It's one of the largest in the UK. It is said that over 11,000 Jewish people still reside here, while a very much larger Jewish population has moved out in recent years. Several hundred copies of scriptures have been welcomed and received into Jewish homes over the past 2 years. The last 2 months have seen the warmest and best reception yet. 4 providential encounters with Jewish people have taken place recently, which have assured us that we are in the will of the Lord as we prayerfully move to distribute His precious word. Now, as it says, there are four reports. I've spread these out over a number of these recordings. And the first one says, we called at a special koshery store, asking for the manager, and a young bearded man seemed at first reluctant to speak with us. However, as we spoke of our love for the Jewish people and our desire to pass him a free copy of the precious scriptures given to the world through his people, he visibly melted. Taking his copy in his hand, he asked if he could have an additional copy for the 10 members of his staff who worked daily beside him. All of them Jewish, of course. We were delighted to fulfill his request and felt the Lord was answering the prayers of his people for us. And the prayer is based on Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. Almighty God, Jehovah, thine ancient people, the Jews, are still so precious to thyself. And thy word shows that a time will come when Jew and Gentile are both grafted in to the vine. Into the vine who is the Messiah himself. The Lord Jesus Christ, who spoke, that he said, I am the vine. And he is the one who is drawing unto himself a people. A people so precious unto thyself, Jehovah. And that even in the midst of blindness of heart, thy word is well able to speak to hearts. And as thy word brings peace, thy word brings hope, thy word brings comfort, and thy word brings lost souls to see that you have provided the way unto yourself through the Messiah, thy beloved Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and his one perfect offering for sin at Calvary, made through his own precious, precious blood, whereby no more sacrifices need to be made. And for these dear, dear ones who so faithfully go out with thy word, for the society of the Hebrew Scriptures, that wherever they go, whether it be in the United Kingdom or in other countries, that it will be thy precious word, the Scriptures, which will open hearts, and the Holy Spirit will speak to hearts based on your word, that your word will be the living word and bring souls, whether they be Jew or Gentile, unto the living God. Thank thee, O Father, for this news so wonderful, so precious. And this prayer is asked in the name of thy beloved Son, the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, and for thy glory. Our second report is from Hudson Taylor Ministries, and it shows that what it is like, this particular article, to be part of the persecuted in China. And here in the United Kingdom, the body of Christ, that is, those who belong to Christ, not simply those who believe that there is someone called Jesus, but don't actually have Jesus within their hearts, but those who have Jesus dwelling within them. And because Jesus dwells within them, then they're persecuted. And it's becoming more open now in the United Kingdom that to belong to Jesus Christ brings persecution, brings suffering, brings rejection. And that enables us to move on in intercession, move on in prayer. Because as this happens to ourselves, God is engineering the circumstances whereby we can identify more fully with these dear, dear Christians in other parts of the world who in their countries have suffered persecution for many years. And one of these countries is China. Yes, there is a turning to the Lord in China. Thousands upon thousands, so the reports tell us, are coming to receive Jesus Christ as Savior and as Lord, to come to belong to him. But in the midst of it all, there are those who are being picked out, those who are being fully identified with what Jesus talked about, of taking up the cross daily and following him. Because his sufferings are being outworked in them. And it has the sufferings of the Lord Jesus Christ are outworked in them, and now being outworked in the persecuted church in the United Kingdom, the body of Christ, then God will do more and more. He'll bring more and more to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, because the more that the body of Christ is persecuted, the more the church, the true church, the body of Christ, those who know that they have been bought with a price, with the blood of the Lord Jesus, will grow. Not just grow numerically, which it will, but will grow to be more identified with him, separated from that which calls itself Christianity and church, but does not know the living Christ living within their hearts, living his life in and through them. And this report is on attorney Zhang Kai, and it says disappeared. So that's quite something when it's an attorney here, not someone who was seen as, in the eyes of the world and community, as insignificant, but someone who had a very responsible position. It says on August 25, which I take it is this year, Chinese police conducted night raids in Wenzhou, also known as China's Jerusalem, in which several pastors were seized, along with prominent citizen attorney Zhang Kai and his assistant Lai Wu Peng. In July, as the Chinese Communist Party was rounding up human rights lawyers, Zhang announced the formation of a group of some 30 Christian lawyers who would defend churches under attack in the southern coastal province of Zhejiang. He called the group Lawyers for the Protection of the Cross, citing information from police and Christians in Wenzhou. Zhang's employer, Yang Xin Quan, said Zhang reportedly has been charged with national security offences. This could see Zhang spend 6 months in secretive detention. Grave concerns are held for his safety. Previously, on August 8, Zhang shared his thinking with his friends on WeChat. I've made up my mind, he said. The most they can do is jail me. But if I stay silent, I'll regret it my whole life. Unfortunately, we know from the experience of another prominent internationally acclaimed Christian human rights lawyer, J.O. Zai Sheng, that jail is not the most they can do. When the Chinese Communist Party released J.O. in August 2014, he was a totally broken man, pale, skeletal, limping, his teeth and hair falling out, unable to string a sentence together because of years of torture, starvation, and solitary confinement. The Chinese Communist Party was saying, this is what happens to lawyers who work against the Chinese Communist Party. Please pray for China, its Christians and its Christian lawyers. That's quite some account. very short account. And he chose the cost to be not just simply someone who believes in the Christ, who believes in the God, but one who has the living God in Christ Jesus dwelling, living within. That as Jesus was despised and rejected during his earthly ministry, so those whom he indwells, who he lives, face the reality of being despised and rejected in these days. And here is this dear brother in Christ. We must stand with ones like him. It's our responsibility. And when the brother in Christ has given his all for Christ. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 12. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. Father, this dear, dear son of thine, and brother in Christ, Ziankai, has not denied thy beloved son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He is fully identified with him. And he has stood for those who were suffering for Christ. He was prepared to be identified with them. And because of this, he also has entered into that suffering. That wherever he may be at this time, whether he is still in detention, or where, whatever. O Father, may he know that nothing whatsoever shall separate him from the love of God in Christ Jesus. That Ziankai is representative of possibly millions throughout the world who are suffering because Jesus is everything to them. Jesus is their very life. They know what it is to have been crucified with Christ. They know what it is, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth within me. Their suffering. Yet no one suffered more than thy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He was despised. He was rejected. He suffered as God. God was rejected. And, O Father, may even in the most awful of circumstances and conditions, reading of this other dear brother, that when he was released, basically, he was a wreck. Yet, the day of miracles has not ended. And you are fully able. The power of the blood of Jesus. And there is still power in the name of Jesus. And I ask for this dear brother, Jiao Ji Sheng, whose body was broken, when he was released from prison. Ask for a complete healing for him, because there is healing, still healing, in the atoning blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And nothing is impossible with God in Jesus Christ. And that this dear brother, Jiao Zheng, is healed. And this other brother, Zhang Kai, wherever he is, you know all about him. That he will, in the most extreme of conditions, whatever he's facing, be more than conqueror in Christ Jesus. Because Jesus has the victory. Jesus has overcome all that the evil one, all that Satan has to bring against Zhang Kai and against others, other Christians throughout the world who are being persecuted. Thank you, O Father, that it is the Church triumphant, it is the body of Christ triumphant, that the more they afflict, the more that they bring against thy people, the more the Church will grow, the body of Christ will grow, and the more that thy people in Christ will become more and more as Christ. That there will be many, many who have Christ shining through the darkness within their lives. For this is asked, O Father, in the name which you cannot deny, that of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, that you shall be glorified through the Son. Now share a very interesting report. Seems I've had it from early September, but here we are, there's always a time to share. And it's by someone called Mark Ellis, and I'm extremely thankful for this report. It's called The Day Jesus Invaded a Buddhist Monastery in the Himalayas. Well, that's quite something for a start off, the title itself. It says Tyler Connell with the Ekbalo Project is currently in the Himalaya Mountains, in one of the most unreachable places of the world, distributing Bibles, praying for the sick, and preaching the good news. That's an encouragement in itself. The gospel has to go to every creature, even those who live in these seemingly most unreachable places of the world. And there the word of God is going, the written word. Sick being prayed for, and the gospel being preached. Nothing can stop the work of Almighty God. Satan and these cohorts, oh, they come along and they interfere. But ultimately, they can't stop the gospel reaching every creature. Continuing the report, we hope to get a Bible in every home and every village in the next 2 years, Tyler noted in a recent blog post. It's exciting to be a small part in changing history in Nepal with God. With God, yes, God doing his own work through man and through woman. The Ekbelo Project uses film as a mobilizing spark on college campuses and churches to send believers into the unreached, unengaged regions of the world. A month ago, Tyler and his team trekked to a village called Yong, one of the highest villages in the Tibetan region of Nepal. We arrived, desperate to hear where the spirit was wanting us to walk, he recounted. They split into groups of four and prayed for the Holy Spirit to direct their paths. Tyler's group felt led to walk to the highest point of the village, where they observed ancient ruins protruding above them. At the moment they reached the promontory, a monk appeared, smiling as he approached them. "Hi, I am Gems," he said in perfect English. "We've been watching you guys. It is rare for anyone foreign to come to our village. Would you like to come inside our monastery?" Tyler and his teammates looked at each other with wonderment and smiled, sensing it was a God moment. They entered the monastery and were met by men and boys of all ages, studying on the Lama of the mountain. They met the Lama and proceeded to continue to converse with their new friend, Gems, who studied under the Dalai Lama in Dharamsala, India, and learned English there. "We are followers of Jesus, the man and God greater than any other God," Tyler told the monk. "Oh, I once heard of Jesus in India, but wasn't able to do any reading on who he was," the man replied. "Can we introduce you to him through the power of the Holy Spirit and the presence of Jesus?" one asked. He said, "Yes," and put out his hands, Tyler recounts. "And suddenly the power and peace of God descended. His eyes got big. He began to take steps back and began to laugh and shake his head in disbelief. He told us he'd never felt a peace or power like this. We proceeded to give him the gospel and the Bible, and then insisted we come back in the morning to meet his other monk friends." Twelve hours later, Tyler and his team returned. This time Gems was coming down the mountain as they were ascending. He said he wasn't able to spend time with them because he had errands to run, but he invited them to meet with the other monks. They entered the monastery again and were met by a monk in his late 20s. He invited us into the idol room, the Holy of Holies for the monastery. It was dark, dank, heavy, and strange. Perfect ingredients for the lightning of the gospel to break into, Tyler recounts. And they sat down. One of the team received the word that someone was injured in the monastery. "Was anyone injured in the earthquake?" they asked. The man's eyes widened. Yes, I myself was injured, and my back is in pain, he replied. They asked if they could pray, right there in the name of Jesus, for healing, and the monk agreed. And as they began to pray, a sweet, heavy glory filled the idle room. The man had the same experience as Jem's. I feel a peace and a power like never before, the monk exclaimed. It feels as though this major blessing has entered into me. He tested his back and discovered he was completely healed, saying it felt like a hot and icy sensation covered his body. The monk said he had heard of Jesus 15 years ago, when a man came to the village and told stories about Jesus. But he couldn't read, so he didn't fully understand who Jesus was. Thankfully, we had a translator, and she explained the entire gospel to him and gave him a Bible. He was grinning from ear to ear and was so thankful and told us he wanted to read more and was going to pray and ask Jesus to reveal himself to him. We were overjoyed at the kindness of Jesus. We handed out more Bibles to monks and joyfully skipped down the mountain, remembering with gratitude the day Jesus invaded a Buddhist monastery. What an amazing account. But yet, Jesus, he's amazing. He works where it is humanly impossible to work. For nothing is impossible with Jesus. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Father, this is a quite amazing account of those whom you have called to go forth with the gospel message, to reach out even to seemingly unreachable places, places that are so remote. And you took these dear, dear ones, brothers and sisters in Christ, to this village and opened the way for them to go into this monastery and to be able to share Jesus with these monks, even in their inner sanctuary, as it were, the room full of idols, and that Bibles were distributed. There was an openness amongst these Buddhist monks, and that shows, that confirms that there are no barriers to the Holy Spirit, that even where there are those who are seemingly being held in the darkness by Satan, yet the barriers are coming down, the barriers are being removed, and that the gospel is reaching where it's not been able to reach before. Thank thee, O Father, for thee, that through Jesus, this dear Buddhist was healed of his back condition. And that now that the Bibles have been left there, Jesus was amongst those people in peace and his presence. That Jesus will come to dwell within the hearts of these Buddhist monks. That they shall know the truth of thy word, and the truth shall make them free. And that they shall know the way to confess sins, that it is through thy beloved Son there is forgiveness of sins, through repentance, through faith, through the cleansing of his blood, reconciled unto thyself through the blood of the Son of God. And that what has been done in that one monastery can be done throughout the whole world. That those who, for centuries, places that have not been accessed with the gospel, that they shall be accessed. That everywhere that still has to be reached will be reached, and the glorious gospel made known, to fulfill that which needs to be fulfilled before the return of thy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, at his second coming upon earth. This is asked, O Father, through the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and for thy glory. Amen. Another country which was in great darkness for many, many years under communism, and in many ways too still has darkness, the darkness of the Roman Catholic religion, and that is Cuba. But even there, God is at work, calling a people unto himself through Jesus Christ, even through the darkness of Roman Catholicism. He's able to work in any situation. Nothing is beyond God. Nothing is impossible to him, because he has provided the means unto himself. Yes, sin cuts off from God, but yet God's love has provided the way whereby sin can be forgiven. Forgiven through Jesus. And this report is from someone called Heather Sells, CBN news reporter. And it's called, In Midst of Hardships, Cubans Catch Mission Fever. Havana, missions into and out of Cuba, is booming thanks to changes in U.S.-Cuban relations and relaxed travel restrictions. Some church leaders are even calling it a missions tsunami. Brian Stewart, a missionary to Cuba with Action International Ministries, leads pastoral teaching teams on short-term trips to the island throughout the year. He told CBN News that since President Barack Obama announced his intent to normalize relations with Cuba last December, he's seen a tremendous increase in interest in short-term missions. Many say they felt a burden for Cuba for decades, he explained. Yes, prayer, intercession, was being made far Cuba, and that God heard it over the years. And the time comes, wherever it is, whatever country, where God opens the way. Yes, a country could have been shut out for years, many, many years. But God does, he has his plan. Because he wants those out of every nation to be part of the body of Christ. Now that it's easier to travel there, and awareness is heightened, many American believers want to go and support the Cuban church. Any leader who's excited, who's trying to find where to be involved in the world, to take his church to an exciting piece of Christianity, they think of Cuba. Jason Carlisle, director of Hispanic Mobilization for the International Mission Board, told CBN News. Still, Carlisle and other mission leaders are cautious, urging Americans to go primarily as learners and encouragers. We have to understand the gospel has been growing tremendously in Cuba for the last 15 years, Carlisle said. So it's not like we're going to this close country where the gospel has not reached. It has. The believers are growing incredibly, just amazingly. House churches are being planted everywhere. Mission strategists are beginning to realize just how quickly the Cuban church planting movement has grown. In the last 20 years, it has started more than 15,000 churches. Word of their testimonies. The movement takes advantage of what normally would be considered liabilities. A shortage of space, resources, and funds. Instead, the church in Cuba has grown using simple tools like the Bible, new believer testimonies, cell groups, and house churches. Carlisle explained how Cuban believers reproduce so quickly. You take the living word of God. You teach it to people. You share the gospel. They become disciples. You disciple them. And then you begin to start house churches, he said. A Christian-owned farm in the Cuban countryside showcases the Cuban church's passion and creative approach in sharing the gospel. The farm helps to fund a mission school that trains church-approved candidates for a year and then sends them to unreached areas of the country. Pastor Yuan founded the school in obedience to a calling from the Lord. He told CBN News, "The vision of opening the school for missions was planted in our hearts by God. He seized on a unique moment in Cuban history in 2008 when the government gave land to farmers. He took on fields plagued with thorny vegetation to fulfill a vision for a self-sustaining ministry. Today, close on 100 alumni of the school have established new churches. We don't have a luxurious building or classrooms," he said. "And these could be some obstacles to the work of the Lord. There could be reasons to say, I can't do anything. But this doesn't stop us. We are moved by the vision and passion that we have. Next part says ascending nation. That vision and passion has led to a global focus on the Cuban church. Despite limited resources, it has started a missions movement of its own and has begun sending Cuban missionaries to other countries. Pastor Julio told CBN News, "Cuba is a missionary country. As a matter of fact, we've been preparing for many years to send people to other countries, but our obstacle has been our economy. We want to fulfill the prophecy that many missionaries will go to the nations," another pastor told CBN News. Missions experts marvel at how God has uniquely prepared Cuban Christians. The hardships they have endured living in poverty helps tremendously in adapting on the mission field. The needs, the scarcity that we've gone through have been preparing us to go, Pastor Julio explained. What Cubans have grown up in is what can be reproduced in just about any country of the world, particularly in areas that are harder to access because you don't have a lot of resources. You don't have to take a worship team, Carlisle noted. Cuban Christians also understand how to multiply the church using simple methods of church planting that require few resources. In a telling sign, the International Mission Board recently finished a multi-year effort that brought in Latin American mission teams to Cuba to observe church planting and discipleship work. The International Mission Board hopes other Latin American countries can learn from Cuba's successes and imitate its tremendous church growth. Another wonderful, wonderful report. The Cuba, a country, yes, as it were, a closed communist country for many, many years. But yet, this account shows that over the past 20 years, and particularly the last 15 years, God has been at work in this country, doing his own work. And these dear, dear people are now missions orientated. They're seeking to reach out to others in other countries. That's quite something. That's God at work. No barriers there. May have been barriers at one time. And undoubtedly intercession and prayer remove those barriers. And Acts chapter 13 and verse 47. "For so hath the Lord commanded us, saying, I have set thee to be a light to the Gentiles, that thou shouldst be for salvation unto the ends of the earth." No exclusions. No matter what barriers may be in the way at the moment in various countries. These barriers shall be removed. God does hear intercessory prayer. And that's the great encouragement, bringing these reports to show that there have been men and women over the years who would have stood in intercessory prayer before God, will not take no for an answer. And Cuba has responded, and not just responded, but now is looking to reach out to other countries. Father, our hearts are filled with praise, with worship, with adoration, that you are, your ways are not our ways, your thoughts are not our thoughts, because your ways and your thoughts are way, they're so far above what we could even think of, what we could even imagine. But yet, you are working out your plan day by day. And there have been those who, down the years, have been so faithful in intercessory prayer for Cuba. And the intercessions reach thyself. They came to you through the name of Jesus. And you answered in the most marvelous way. And as these prayers, these intercessions continue faithfully through your intercessors worldwide, still to open up those areas of the world, those nations of the world which still need to be opened up, and even to overcome the barriers that have been placed in nations like the United Kingdom and the United States of America. That just as with Cuba, you will work thine own miracle in the midst of these barriers, even should it be through an underground church, because you cannot be denied, and the work of God shall continue. It will continue for thy glory. It will continue for bringing unto thyself those through whom you want to have fellowship. That you will do your miracles. You will do your work. And neither Satan nor devils or all the powers of darkness, all the evil spirits in hell, in heavenly places, are in the various countries of the world. None shall be able to prevent, ultimately, thy plan being fulfilled, because you even take of the things which Satan does and turn them to fulfill that which you want to fulfill. Because you fulfilled what you wanted to fulfill in Cuba. And you have now called ones, laid upon their hearts, to actually go out, reach out from Cuba. And for ones from other parts of that region of the world to come, and to see what you have done, and to go back to their own countries, and to put into place that which they have learnt. Thank thee, O Father, through the name of Jesus, through the power of the blood of Jesus, this has all been done, for thy glory and for thy glory alone. Amen.
Just have a look, because yes, time's moving on, so I'll make this one the last report for today. And it's come from a ministry that I've only recently come into contact with, but yet a most wonderful work which has been raised by God himself, called Iran Alive Ministries. You might think, what are you talking about here? Iran? Yes, God's at work in Iran in amazing ways. You might not hear it on the news that is controlled by Satan,
But God has his own news, his own reports.
And it says, in fact, I've got more than one, but we'll just use the first one today. Two miracle conversions through our counseling centre, this is called. Just turn the scripture up, ready. Sha'ia and her husband's journey to faith started when 20-year-old Sha'ia, not her real name, learned she was pregnant. Her husband insisted she abort the baby. Sha'ia refused, and after giving birth, her husband then demanded that the baby be sold. Terrified, she fled with her infant daughter. While in hiding, Sharla watched our TV broadcast and called our counseling center to give her life to Christ. Our counselors then arranged a Bible for Sharla and connected her with our online community of believers to help her grow in faith. Sharla was shocked when her husband found her 6 months later. She braced for the worst. However, she convinced him to watch our broadcast. By watching, his countenance totally changed, and he called our counseling center to thank us for helping his family. He then immediately gave his life to Christ over the phone and reconciled with his family. Our counseling center has received more than 65,000 calls from people like Sharla and her husband since 2001, with more than 22,000 people indicating decisions for Christ. It is a work that is only possible through the support of friends like you. Please pray that God will continue to move in a miraculous way in the lives of people like Sharla and her husband. And the scripture is Jeremiah chapter 49 and verse 38. And I will set my throne in Elam, that is, Elam is present day Iran, and will destroy from thence the king and the princes, saith the Lord. Father, no one can stay thy hand, even in a country like Iran, that you are working out your own plan, that where the evil one seeks to do his worst, you seek to do your best, and you do your best, because you provided thy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. You gave that which was the most precious to yourself. And as the message of the Lord Jesus Christ is shared by this ministry in Iran, then more and more will come to know thyself as God through Jesus Christ. Thank thee, O Father God, that with this prayer and all the prayers that have gone before, none shall be denied, because Jesus said, "It is finished." When he spoke those last words on the cross, and because it is finished, and the way unto thyself is opened through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, then the gospel message will reach every creature in every nation throughout this world. Everyone shall be given the opportunity to come unto thyself, because it is asked through the name which you cannot deny,
that of Jesus Christ, and through the power of the blood of Jesus, for thy glory and for thy glory alone. Amen.